forearm is divided into an anterior forearm and a posterior forearm, compartmentalized nicely. When you learn about the nerves, you will learn about nerves of the anterior compartment versus the posterior compartment. The anterior forearm has muscles that mostly pass into the hand for movement of the wrist or the fingers. There are, however, a few muscles that are for movement of the forearm itself. Notice that most of the forearm muscles come from the anterior surface of the medial epicondyle of the humerus, so they do cross the elbow joint, and we call that area the common flexor tendon. Now on this model we can see one muscle that heads from medial to lateral across the front of the forearm, where it will wrap around the posterior lateral aspect of the radius. This muscle is called the pronator teres muscle. As its name implies, its function is pronation of the forearm. Now, if we look at the model carefully, running straight down the anterior surface of the forearm and passing superficial to a band of connective tissue called the flexor retinaculum is a muscle known as the palmaris longus. This muscle's origin is off of that anterior medial epicondyle of the humerus, but it does not insert anywhere on this model. That is because its insertion is not a bony insertion. It inserts into the skin of the hand on the deep side of the connective tissue, the skin of the hand. And since this model is for showing muscles, the skin has been removed. So they have cut this muscle off right here, the palmaris longus muscle. This muscle is absent in roughly 16% of people. If you don't have a palmaris longus, it is really of no consequence. To the lateral side of palmaris longus, we can see running along the radius and inserting just past the carpal bones of the wrist is the flexor carpi radialis muscle. Conversely, on the medial side, we see running along the length of the ulna and inserting just past the carpal bones of the wrist is the flexor carpi ulnaris. They are both named for their action, flexion at the wrist, flexor carpi, radialis running along the radius, and ulnaris running along the ulna. Now, if on this model we could peel away the palmaris longus muscle, we would see a wider muscle underneath it called the flexor digitorum superficialis muscle. Now, the flexor digitorum superficialis is named for both its position and its function. Flexor digitorum tells you it's going to flex the digits, digits 2, 3, 4, and 5, and it is more superficial than another muscle. This is one of the muscles that divides into four tendons that will pass through the carpal tunnel out to the digits of the fingers. On this particular model, they make it very hard to see the flexor digitorum superficialis muscle. It is this wide muscle here underneath the palmaris longus. Now, if I remove this part of the model and turn it around, on the back side, you would be looking at the flexor digitorum superficialis muscle. Now, if I put this back on just temporarily, if we have a flexor digitorum superficialis, we know we must have a flexor digitorum profundus. So if I remove the superficialis and the muscles that remove with it, the muscle immediately beneath will be the flexor digitorum profundus. It also flexes digits 2, 3, 4, and 5. Now the insertion point of these two muscles is different, but it is beyond the scope of what we're teaching in A&P1. So flexor digitorum profundus flexes digits 2, 3, 4, and 5. The muscle that we removed, the flexor digitorum superficialis, also flexes digits 2, 3, 4, and 5. Provides for a very strong grip. These are very large muscles in the forearm. Notice we've talked about digits 2, 3, 4, 5. We have yet to address anything with the thumb, or digit 1. The thumb is also known as the pollex. Alongside, just lateral to the flexor digitorum profundus, we will see the flexor pollicis longus muscle. And if we look carefully at the model, it passes toward the wrist and then out into the hand where we can see its tendon going all the way to the distal phalanx of the thumb, the flexor pollicis longus muscle. Now there is another pronator muscle. It cannot be seen on these models. It is known as the pronator quadratus, and it would be deep to these other muscles, approximately here, about an inch from the wrist, spanning between the ulna and the radius. So those are the muscles of the anterior compartment of the forearm. Let's turn this around and look at muscles of the posterior compartment of the forearm. Muscles of the posterior compartment of the forearm are all innervated by the radial nerve or branches thereof. If we look right along the lateral aspect of the forearm, we will see a muscle known as the brachioradialis, named because it comes from the brachium and inserts into the styloid process of the radius, the brachioradialis muscle. It is a very strong flexor at the elbow if the forearm is halfway between pronation and supination. Immediately adjacent to the flexor, or excuse me, the brachioradialis muscle, is the extensor carpi radialis longus and the extensor carpi radialis brevis. Extensor carpi radialis longus is in the extensor compartment, the posterior forearm, and runs along the radius to insert into the carpal bones, and right next to it, the extensor carpi radialis brevis, inserting also into the carpal bones. So extending at the wrist, running along the radius. If we look to the medial side of the forearm, we will see a muscle running along the ulna that inserts just past the carpal bones, the extensor carpi ulnaris muscle. Now in this case, there is no longus or brevis, just extensor carpi ulnaris. Immediately medial and slightly higher than the origin for the extensor carpi ulnaris, we see a small triangular-shaped muscle which goes from the posterior lateral epicondyle of the humerus into the posterior shaft of the ulna. This muscle is known as the anconeus muscle. If you watch the video on the muscles of the arm, I said that some books consider the posterior arm to have two muscles. This is the muscle that is sometimes considered to be posterior arm, and in other books is considered to be posterior forearm, the anconeus muscle. Now if we look at the remainder of the posterior forearm, we can see a large muscle running along the back of the posterior forearm that will divide into four tendons. These tendons go to digits 2, 3, 4, and 5. Since this is the extensor compartment of the forearm, and we're going to the digits, this is called the extensor digitorum muscle. It will extend digits 2, 3, 4, and 5. And if you look carefully on the model, you can see that breaking away from the extensor digitorum, there is a smaller muscle, very narrow, which goes only to the little finger. That is the extensor digiti minimi muscle. The extensor digiti minimi. Now the posterior forearm, like the anterior forearm, was divided into layers. So if I remove the different muscle layers, as the model allows, I will remove the muscle bellies, mostly of extensor digitorum, extensor digiti minimi, and extensor carpi ulnaris, and we can see underneath some of the other muscles we need to discuss. And I'm also going to remove the muscles that are over on the lateral aspect of the forearm, which were the brachioradialis, the extensor carpi radialis longus, and brevis. Now we can see the deep compartment of the posterior forearm. Wrapping around from the olecranon process of the ulna and the lateral epicondyle of the humerus and wrapping around the radius, we see the muscle known as the supinator muscle. As its name implies, the supinator muscle supinates the forearm. Immediately below the insertion of the supinator muscle, we have a muscle which wraps laterally around to insert at the base of the first metacarpal bone, the metacarpal that goes to the thumb. This is called the abductor pollicis longus muscle. Abductor pollicis longus. This is the muscle that allows us to take our thumb away from the rest of the hand, abduction of the thumb. Immediately distal to that muscle, we see the extensor pollicis brevis muscle, and next to that, on the model, we can't see it cutting across the remainder of the muscles that we weren't able to remove, but we can see the tendon of the extensor pollicis longus muscle. And very poorly indicated on these models is yet one more muscle that passes underneath the other muscles that were not removable, the extensor digitorum and the extensor digiti minimi, and its tendon comes out to join only to the index finger, and that is the extensor indices muscle. So with the extensor indices muscle, we can extend only the index finger while keeping the other fingers flexed. With the extensor digiti minimi, we can extend only the small finger, the digiti minimi, while keeping the other fingers flexed. With the extensor digitorum, we can extend all of the digits of the hand. Now, one more thing I want to put in, I want to add these different muscle pieces back in. I want to show a small trick for learning the muscles leading from the lateral part of the posterior forearm around to the posterior forearm. Remember, we had the brachial radialis, then we had the extensor carpi radialis longus, then the brevis, then the abductor pollicis longus, then the extensor pollicis brevis, and the extensor pollicis longus. If we ignore the brachial radialis, then we simply alternate longus and brevis. Extensor carpi radialis longus, then there's a brevis, then there's a longus, then there's a brevis, then there's another longus. Extensor carpi radialis longus, extensor carpi radialis brevis. Abductor pollicis longus, extensor pollicis brevis, extensor pollicis longus. The muscles of the posterior forearm.